I'd like to frame and define for you what a 21st century spiritual seeker is all about, what they go through, what they're faced with. And if you don't mind, I wrote up a parable, and I would like to read it to you. And it's called The Parable of the Wandering Seeker. Let's see, I better pull this up closer to my eyeballs here. All right, The Parable of the Wandering Seeker. Please bear with me. There was a man who constantly searched for the secret to his happiness. This man knew that since no one was really happy, including himself, that there must be a hidden secret to ultimate bliss and happiness. Everything else had a secret, like the secret to wealth, love, friendship, and popularity. And so he naturally felt there must be a secret to lasting happiness. He was determined to find this secret. So he first pursued the secret of wealth and amassed great riches. He next pursued the secret of love, was blessed with a good wife, and had many children. He then gathered friends and became the most popular among them. But even though he was very thankful for what he possessed, there still remained a void of emptiness within his heart. He finally concluded that the secret to happiness, could only exist in either the pursuit of the psychic arts or through the traditional religions. And so he dabbled in spiritualism, psychic healing, and positive mind theories. But rather than shedding the karmic barriers, he seemed to have acquired more. He then became a Hindu, followed by a Buddhist, and finally a Christian, studying diligently the Bhagavad Gita, the Dhammapada, and the Holy Bible, gaining wise knowledge from them all. But the ultimate secret to his happiness still eluded him, and he became visibly distraught, and much like a wildfire, his unhappiness consumed him. His entire lifetime had passed before him, and while feebly lying upon his deathbed, he summoned a wise man and put a heart-rending question to the noble sage. Where did I go wrong? I pursued and attained all of the values and ideals of our society and was a faithful devotee of the psychic arts and the religious institutions. And I openly admit that I have not discovered the ultimate secret to my own happiness. Can you offer to me, O wise man, any wisdom on my plight? And the wise man said, my dear man, you have externalized your search and pursued the secret to happiness in all the wrong places. Please realize the hidden secret, that you alone have been the object of your search all along. The secret to lasting happiness is within you. Apply yourself there. That very hour, the noble sage gave to the elderly man the secrets of his own inner kingdom, and his lifetime quest was finally realized. Now, dear ones, the MasterPath specializes in wandering seekers. We come down into this world. We want the truth. We yearn for the truth. And yet all we can follow is what has been recommended to us, whether it be the goals of society, the goals of the psychic arts, or the goals of the church. And how many people are there that have followed these recommendations diligently and really have not quelled or found the secret to their happiness. There are very, very many people that fall into this situation. And the master path is diametrically opposed to being a seeker of spirituality and not getting anywhere. This particular man who was seeking became so enamored with religions and the psychic arts and the goals of mankind that he forgot all about himself. The master path is about finding your true self. It's based on self and God realization. That's the whole stance of the light and sound doctrine. Someone may ask, Sri Gary, what were the secrets that the noble sage whispered into the man's ear? Can I tell you that everything is secret? There's a secret teaching. There's a secret door that you can go through. There's a secret spiritual current that you can contact. There's a secret path. There's a secret way to center your consciousness and rise up into your third eye. Everything is secret. Mankind just does not know about it. The masters and saints of previous times and of the present times carry with them the ability to convey and release certain secrets to the new seekers. And many say, oh, come on, Gary, there's nothing new under the sun. But there is. And once you are conveyed these secrets, once you learn to understand what the true path may entail, it can save you lifetimes of spiritual search and endeavor. And you say, well, Sri Gary, could you please tell me some of these secrets? Well, I'll be glad to give you one of them. The first one is what's called the true doctrine. And one says, the true doctrine, I'm familiar with all the doctrines of the world. The Bible and the Shastras and the Vedas, the Torah, the Talmud, the Bhagavad Gita. Dear ones, the scriptures of the world and all the different religions of the world, like Ramakrishna experienced himself. He set out as a young man to experience all the religions, and his conclusion was that every religion took one to the same place. And of course, the same place is the God of the religions, which is this realm right here called the causal plane, or the realm of Tricuti. This is the conventional God, and this is where all the religious scriptures and the incarnations have come from. And this is where the scriptures and devotion to these incarnations take one back to. The true doctrine is something completely different. The masters have a monopoly on the true doctrine. And you say, well, Sri Gary, what is the true doctrine? Well, if you don't have the true doctrine, you never are going to be able to find out your point of origin. You're never going to be able to find out the way in which you're to get back to your point of origin. And the true doctrine is truly esoteric and secret. How many people of the new seekers realize that there's all of these chakras or plexus within your body, and each one deal with major kingdoms and realms of experience? Some people know about the chakras, but many more do not. How about the true doctrine of the bodies that are encased within our physical body. Hardly anyone realizes that we have five distinct bodies, not just our physical body. The true doctrine is secret because of this chart. Here are the levels of heaven that we actually will, in time, move through and attain. To a normal human being, there are three regions. There's hell, there's the earth plane, and there's heaven. To a MasterPath student or one pursuing the doctrine of light and sound, there are eight spiritual levels of heaven above and beyond the physical plane that we are now inhabiting. And the true teachings describe to one the sacred door in which one has to penetrate and render the veil. They explain how the regions above that you enter into in your soul form, the astral and tricuti and daswan and banwar gufa, and all the way up into the kingdom of heaven, which there are four distinct levels. Very, very few people have the true doctrine. And as a secret to the teachings and to the new seeker themselves, when they come in possession of this secret of the true teachings, it helps them immensely in comprehending who they are, the journey they're about to take, what the objective is to be. So the true teachings are one of the things that the master whispered into this individual's ear when he was on his deathbed. The next true secret that the master uttered to the dying man was the true sound current. Now, this is revolutionary. This, the sound, is the same thing as spirit. What is so revolutionary about the sound, compared to a normal man's thinking process, is that the great spirit does not just exist on the physical plane. If you were to ask a Christian who the true spirit was, they would say, well, the Holy Spirit is the true essence of God. Well, that's the Holy Spirit on the physical plane. The level of purity of the spiritual current at this level, the lowest one, is as coarse as it can get. As life-giving as it can be to a human being, the spiritual current on this plane is very inferior to the spiritual current on this plane. This plane right here deals with light. And you know of many, many paths that are light paths. As you go up, the spiritual current on this plane far transcends the spiritual current on this plane and becomes more pure. This plane right here will bring you cosmic consciousness and deals with the universal mind power. As you rise up, the spiritual current becomes purified and more concentrated. And once again, it becomes more concentrated as you go up to the next region, all the way into the kingdom of heaven, which is called the true home of soul, the true plane of soul. This was its original departing point. This is where it descended from, all the way down into the physical plane, yugas, eons, millennium, that can't be counted. And in time, the very soul that's encased within the human body will gradually start to make its way back up to the kingdom of heaven. Now, the masters deal with the true sound current. Most people in the world deal with the Holy Spirit, or they deal with the light. And the light and sound doctrine differentiates clearly between the true spiritual current, which is sound, and the universal mind power, which is the power and current that runs the mind. And if I may briefly outline this for you, the universal mind power originates right here. And the ruler is Brahm, or the conventional God of Christianity. If you look at any of the Eastern teachings, every Eastern teaching, almost exclusively, is attempting to get the individual mind back to Brahm. And Brahm is the creator of the lower worlds. It's the God of the lower worlds. And most seekers in the physical plane feel that Brahm is the ultimate deity, the supreme God of all. In the light and sound doctrine, in contrast, one learns that Brahm is actually an intermediate deity that is responsible for the universal mind power, for enlivening man's mind. It's responsible for the law of karma and all reincarnation that commences in these first three planes. The purpose of the sound current is to take you beyond the realm of the conventional God into self-realization, spiritual realization, and eventually God realization. So the secret of the sound current is truly a fascinating study, and it is what allows every seeker that embraces the light and sound teachings to unfold so quickly and expand so greatly, because the current is far more concentrated in spirit and in truth as compared to a human being's idea of the Holy Spirit or the light, which just deals with the universal mind power. Okay. The third secret that was whispered in this elderly man's ear was the true master. Now, I know this is redundant to a lot of my chelas that have been with me for many years, but to the new seekers, it's not. Now, I realize that masters aren't in vogue in the 21st century. I realize that when a master is mentioned, the mind recoils. It says, I don't need a master. I can do it myself. But I want to be very clear to you that have an objection to masters. Thank you for this little towel. A true master is completely different than an ascended master. An ascended master has translated, is deceased, and is no longer in the world. Didn't even the Holy Bible state that Jesus was saying, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world? How true that was. But the implication behind that verse is that when I'm not in the world, I'm no longer the light of the world. Christians would vehemently disagree with that. But from a truthful light and sound point of view, no, a master. Jesus only initiated those people that were living when he was. Those initiates, even though they're not living right now, are the ones that could depend on Jesus the Christ. Once Jesus the Christ left this world, he was no longer the spiritual authority. And if you study the Bible closely, isn't it true that John the Baptist gave the mantle to Jesus, and Jesus gave it to Peter? And the line has continued. And so a true master, first of all, is not ascended. A true master is a living master. And this makes an incredible difference when one is trying to figure out how to ascend and rise in their spirituality. Here's another point that's pivotal. A lot of people in the world are hypersensitive about cults. Everything is a cult. Hollywood's a cult. Religious paths are a cult. Probably the greatest cults in the world are those that worship an ascended master. Like Christianity, in truth, not being disrespectful in the least towards this particular doctrine, but Christianity worships an ascended master. Buddhism worships an ascended master. Hinduism worships an ascended master. When you worship an ascended master, clearly they are not currently living. And the definition of a cult is when you worship the personality of an organization. You see? And so really, it's your religions that are the biggest cults in the world. Plus, I would like to say that even more dangerous than cults, outer cults, are the inner cults that one can fall victim to. And one says, well, Gary, what's an inner cult? An inner cult is when you worship your own personality. Look how America is into their personality and worships and glorifies their own ego, mind, and personality. That's really all they have going for them, and that they are the victims of an inner cult. Now, this is very important to me because the master path has nothing to do with a cult. A true master will tell you that, say, dear one, I'm not the true master. I'm not the true master. The spiritual current within you is the true master. The sound current, that spiritual force that manifests in your own third eye, this is where all of your worship, your devotion, and your adoration should go. The outer man is just the guide, the way shower, and points the direction to truth. Secondly, a true master is going to inform all of his students that, say, it's not the outer form that's the true master. It's you. You are the true master. And this is why this teaching is called MasterPath. Because it is the divine path to your own mastership. Like I said earlier, we are not sinners, but we're the sons and daughters of God. We were made in God's image, where religions and paths were made in man's image. And so a true master is not going to let, if they are a true bona fide Satguru, a true realized master, they will not allow any of their devotees to worship them. And all the worship and devotion is they instruct to be given to the inner master that resides right in your tisratil, first of all, and second of all, to continuously strive for attaining your own mastership. You are the master and you are the path. Okay. The inner master, which is the true master for the seekers that know nothing about light and sound doctrine, we have the outer master right here. I instruct and teach and guide for you to gather the energy from your body, gather the attention from your body, center it in your third eye, and render the veil of the sacred inner door. That's what this gold door right here represents. It's called the third eye, the tisratil, the eye of Shiva, the single eye. They all refer to this door that resides right above the eyes and about a half inch back in. The outer master wants you to meet the inner master right here. The soul is diffused. Its energy and attention is diffused and scattered all through the body. And through a set of spiritual exercises, the student learns how to Bring this attention into one focal point and center it, concentrate it right in this till. When they do, there's a doorway here that will open, and the soul will go right through this doorway, right in their own inner consciousness. Not out into the far-flung worlds, but right within one's own cranium. That's very important. One doesn't travel anywhere. You stay within the confines of your own bodies. And it is here that you meet the inner master. And the inner master and the soul of the disciple are extraordinarily happy when they meet for the first time. And then these two, the soul and the inner master, step by step, travel through the astral world, the causal realm, the plane of self-realization, the plane of spiritual realization, and finally the inner master releases the soul in the true home of soul on the fifth plane, and now the inner master's job is done. But as a result of this, the soul is now its own master and can take its place among the saints and those God-men that have visited this planet before us. Okay. I tried to give you the three secrets that the noble sage in the parable of the wandering seeker gave to the elderly man. Every seeker in the world is very concerned about being duped or misled or taken advantage of. They want nothing to do with cults, external paths, or deceit or deception of any kind. I totally agree with your point of view. You must be very, very careful. And even what I say, please don't believe me either, because what I am saying to you is still a theory and just an idea or concept. You yourself must rise and center yourself here in the third eye to come into agreement with what I've even told you. But there is a means in which you, through your own experiment, can verify everything that I have mentioned to you tonight. That's the beauty of the light and sound doctrine. You do not take things on faith. You do not take things on hope. You must actually experience these truths for yourself. And now you become a knower. You've experienced them yourself. And then you can fully trust and believe and have faith in something that you have truly experienced. And that's what the light and sound doctrine really recommends. Don't take things on hearsay or on faith alone. You should be able to personally experience these for yourself.